Thank you. Can you hear me okay? It's okay. Well, I'm really grateful to be here. Thank you for the invitation. It's actually been a very humbling trip. Firstly, listening to the amazing work and strategies we've encountered so far, and also just having a chance to talk to some of the students here who sort of seem quite amazing to me so far. So something really amazing happening in this space, I think. I was asked to talk about resistance, and something strange happened to me, I have to admit. It's not the first time we've been asked to talk about such things, but it's not what I needed to do right now, actually. So I've kind of grabbed a slightly different situation, or I've come at it in a slightly odd way, I think even I have to admit. And that's because we're making a new body of work, and I didn't want to talk about something old, I wanted to talk about something new that's in process, and it won't be completed for another year. And as I sat down to write about it, I ended up writing an essay about why we, Karen, I, Övül, and some other people are entering into talking about a contemporary condition by revisiting a situation that happened 20 years ago, almost to the day. So that's the paper I'm going to give. And then afterwards, if we have time in the discussion, we can talk about, well, how we're trying to reclaim agency in such a kind of crazy, violent, patriarchal story that I'm about to tell you. So, today I want to tell you two stories in parallel. One is a story of a car crash, and one is a wider weaving story about some of the conditions of the permanent war and its legal-illegal state tensions. These two stories move between facts and fiction and intertwine to add insight into emerging triangle of conspiracy theory, dismissive authoritarianism, and a victim narrative claimed by the state. As I said, ultimately our idea is to reclaim agency from these stories by asking how we can use this situation for contemporary revolutionary politics. But before that, we first have to move through and past an image which we call the state of the state. This is an image of a car crash known as the Susuluk scandal. It's a crash that happened in November 1996 near the town of Susuluk, about 4-hour drives from Istanbul. I'll return to look at it in detail, but for now I'd just like you to breathe in the image of the crash and its four passengers, a high-ranking policeman, an MP who's the only survivor in the crash, an assassin and a beauty queen. In the back of the car there were drugs, guns, listening devices and fake passports. So as I narrate to you the story of how these four people came to be in the same car, you'll start to see that it's no understatement to say that this accident changed the political discourse of Turkey. This is because this accident not only added to the accumulating evidence of illegal covert actions of the Turkish police, state and mafia, but it also definitively allowed language to form around these actions. For people subjected to multiple methods of domination, this car represents a through line into a series of violent actions that could suddenly become linked together. It was a cataclysm many had long been waiting for, an eruption of causality, so unexpected that it seemed to signal the passage from one world, the world of meaning, beset by ambiguities and contradictions, to another, a realm beyond meaning or marked by a meaning. Of course, it's not the only accident to do such a thing. I mean, I think about the plane crash that led to the sale, that brought to light the sale of US arms to Iran during the US embargo. I think about Chernobyl and how the government actively failed to alert the public for 3 days of what was actually happening with the reactor. In England, we had David Kelly who commits suicide from the just huge pressure of actually trying to call out the lies about weapons of mass destruction. And interestingly, there's this Paul Virilio, who famously places 9/11 at the forefront of his Museum of Accidents, arguing that the plane crash is a condition of the technology of flight itself. So like these, the Susuluk accident is a particularly revelatory gesture, a rendering visible of that which lies beyond the field of vision. an accident catastrophe that is a rupture in the ordinary scream of things, an eruption, a disruption, or even an interruption. A suspension of everyday life, that which wakes us from the dream. And one belief I have about the permanent emergency is that it presents itself as if we are always perpetually to live in the middle of its narrative, never at the beginning or at the end. And one of the strengths of the accidents or the rupture is that it can briefly turn such middles into beginnings by lending a face to that which is faceless or abstract, at least until it is recuperated. And this is the second reason we're drawn to the accident, so we might analyse how it's possible for clear moments of possible change and illumination to be eroded away. As Gumpart suggests about 9/11, 9/11 seems to figure at the very advent of knowledge itself as we move from initial ecstasy and horror, wordless beyond words, to, in the next moment, discourse and determinism, casual, juridical, ethical. Everything turns away quite leisurely from the disaster. Testimony both to its absolute transcendence, the catastrophe is sacrosanct, untouchable, and to its utter insignificance. Things will never be the same. Things are always the same. Things will never be the same. Things are always the same. For me, this repetition is crucial to understanding how meta-narratives like the permanent war or the war on terror are operating, between rupture on the one hand and continuity on the other. The accident defined in terms of these meta-narratives is that which is about to happen, and is that which holds us in a state of suspension. It is as if we collectively and suddenly breathe in together, but we cannot exhale. So, I want to enter another meta-narrative. So the term Ground Zero was first used immediately after the end of the Second World War to describe the epicenter of the atomic bomb blast in Hiroshima. The term is now uniformly used to refer to the site of the World Trade Center, whilst the founders of Turkey also proclaimed the Turkish Republic to be a year zero, thus rendering prehistoric anything that happened before. As a strategy, in the endgame of World War II, one atom bomb apparently would not have sufficed. One bomb suggests a singular event, a fluke, an obscene departure from normality. Two bombs, on the other hand, constitute a way of life. The first bomb has the force of an accident, the second that of an institution. Baudrillard argues, you need two superpowers to keep the universe under control. A single empire would crumble of itself. And the equilibrium of terror alone can allow a regulated opposition to be established, for the strategy is structural, never atomic. Hence the balance of power during the Cold War is not that America and the Soviet Union were at odds with each other, but that structurally speaking, they were the same as each other, both necessary poles in a binary system. And this is an idea that this man understood extremely well. This is Lyman Lemnitzer, one of the senior US officers sent to negotiate the German surrender in 1945. He's a true product of the Cold War, a believer in military rather than civilian control, who rose to become the most powerful unelected man in the United States. You can see him there, he with these other figures. Here he is as the head of the Joint Chiefs of Staff from 1960 to 1962. So that's he's the head of the US Army, the US Navy, and the US Air Force. And the reason I'm focusing on him is because of this. Oops. This is a couple of documents from a few pages, you can find them online, from Operation Northwoods. In 2001, these documents are reclassified, and they show that in 1961, the Joint Chief of Staff, led by Lemnitzer, designed a plan to launch terrorism against the United States in order to trick the American public into supporting a war against Cuba. Operation Northwoods called for people to be shot on American streets, for boats carrying refugees fleeing Cuba to be sunk, for Cuban terror cells to be hosted in Washington, Miami, and elsewhere. All of which would be blamed on Castro. It's a tactic called false flag theory. When a government stages secret operations against its own people, which is then blamed on the enemy. And this itself sits inside another strategy called the strategy of tension, a conscious strategy to divide, manipulate, and control public opinion using fear, propaganda, disinformation, psychological warfare, agent provocateurs, and false flag theory. To covertly maintain the right conditions for a military state to thrive is a precursor to what we call now the permanent emergency or the permanent war. So the reason I'm focusing on that at all is on seeing these memos, the newly elected president, who's JFK, realizes extremely fast he can't work with Lemnitzer, nor can he really demote him. So what he does instead is he exports him and puts him in charge of NATO, where he's the commander from 1962 to 1969. And his command is one of the factors in how Europe comes to have secret armies unknown to their own governments, trained by the CIA and MI6. These secret armies would become known as Gladio, thanks to an Italian judge who was the first to uncover the network in the 1990s. The number of recruits ranged from dozens in some nations to hundreds or even thousands in others. This was, again, with a dual purpose of firstly being a resistance network in case of Soviet invasion, and secondly for sustaining a strategy of tension for internal security and military order against Soviets and leftist influence in Europe. So back to our car crash. So each country has its own story about the Gladio, but in Turkey, a specific set of conditions accelerates the kind of damage done, if you like. So I'd like to pick up the Turkish narrative with the Special Warfare Department, or OHD. This was actually founded in 1953 in line with NATO's anti-Soviet measures, but I kind of want to pick up the story in 1965 when 16 different key Turkish military personnel received funding and training in special warfare by the CIA. In particular, the one I want to focus on is this man here, Colonel Alparslan Türkeş. He is mostly responsible for running the Turkish Gladio unit semi-autonomously, I would say, from the Americans within the Ankara office of the USA, of the CIA. So the Special Warfare Department is inside the state, and it covertly bridges both the police and the military with interweaving departments. The strongest of these is the Secret Service, which the civilian government has no control over whatsoever. In Turkey, there are various secret services, the MIT, National Secret Service Organization, the secret services of the gendarmerie, the general staff, the foreign ministry, the director of security, which is the political police, the psychological warfare department, and the presidential office. So these are not one cohesive unit. They are frequently competing with one another. And there are multiple stories of how one department will arrest someone only for another department to release them because they're sort of double, triple agents, if you like. But why I'm interested in this man is, in addition to his part of this Gladio network, Turkish also sets up or reorganizes a party that existed, a Republican Peasants Nation Party, and he creates this Fascist Nationalist Movement Party, or MHP, which exists to this day. So this is still inside the Turkish democracy, or less so a democracy now. And to support this political entity, he also establishes a youth organization called the Grey Wolves, an unofficial military arm of the MHP. By 1980, there are over 1,800 Grey Wolf groups, over 200,000 members, and they are responsible for multiple acts of violence in support of far-right Turkish nationalism. This is their sign. I can't really do it. Something like this? Yeah. So what did it feel like to be subjected to this growing network of interests? The Turkish, Kurdish, Armenian, and Alevi people began to refer to the covert actions of the state as dead and devlet, or deep state. It is their term used to describe the violence that could remain hidden in plain sight. When a secret operation took place, no one assumed responsibility responsibility for it. There was no judicial process, and many events even became lost in conspiracy theory. Indeed, spreading conspiracy theory is an active tool of the deep state, as the idea of its own existence is emptied when either the attributes included in its definition increase, or the concept gets reduced to being described as a network of interests. This mistakenly creates the illusion that the deep state could be destroyed by imprisoning individual groups. The truth is, the deep state is part of the modern constitutional state and the liberal or neoliberal democracy paradigm. When law is not in the complete control of a political power, the state legitimizes illegal actions as its raison d'etat in a process self-rationalized as self-protection. Seen this way, the definition of deep state is implicit within the definition of the state. The deep state is therefore a mode of domination, both formal and informal, a dual domination. It is a condition that interweaves impunity and amnesia. Turkish author Ece Temelkuran writes, "Turkey has become a true master of the forgetfulness that has perfected the repetition of the practice of forgetting, disinterest and blindness." She is, of course, not only referring to a cycle of amnesia promoted famously by Turkish Prime Minister Demirel in 2003 as "yesterday is yesterday, today is today, tomorrow is tomorrow," but also to the arrest and murder, as we're seeing now, I'll come to that, of thousands of journalists. A blackout as the actual circumstances of the oppression of the Kurdish people and the legislation of Turkification, which extends to words and language that are legal and illegal to use or to learn. So this deep state is not then that which arrives, it is that which returns. What we are waiting for is not the coming of the end, but its second or third or fourth coming. The deep state comes back. It is a disaster of impunity and amnesia that erases the last disaster. And since the disaster always takes place after having taken place, it becomes impossible to grasp the experience of it. So in this context, our car presides not over the telling of the truth, but its transportation. Let us look again at our four passengers. Abdullah Chatli was not just an assassin, extortionist, torturer, and paramilitary commander, but he was also a renowned, heroic former leader of the Grey Wolves. Despite being number 8 on Interpol's wanted list, Chatli had a Turkish diplomatic passport, a gun permit, 6 identity cards, each bearing a different name, and each signed by the Interior Minister of Turkey. Upon Chatli's death, Prime Minister Çiller said, "I do not know whether he is guilty or not, but we will always respectfully remember those who fire bullets or suffer wounds in the name of this country, this nation, and this state." Gonca Uş, in the top right, was dismissed in the press as either Chatli's girlfriend, mistress, a beauty queen, or a prostitute, and even after a short while, her death just ceases to be reported at all. The policeman Hussein Kojedar may possibly have been Alevi, but he hid this in his role of police commissioner whilst in command of multiple covert anti-guerrilla actions against the PKK. And MP Sedat Bujak was not just a democratically elected official, he was also the head of a 30,000 strong Kurdish clan in receipt of 1.3 million a month of government money for providing thousands of village guards or Kurdish paramilitaries to fight the PKK. This was a particularly brutal and successful strategy, pitting Kurdish allies of the Turkish state against the Kurdish resistance movement, a classic tactic from the strategy of tension doctrine. Human Rights Watch has for years and years received reports of violations by these village guards, murders, rapes, robberies, house destruction, illegal property occupation, amongst multiple others. In the car, the weapons and drugs link this car crash to a massive underground mafia network moving drugs, arms and oil beneath the Turkish economy. I'm just moving over to some, just to catch some of these characters. I just don't have time to tell the story of all of them at all. But the weapons in the car links this through to this activity. There were three investigations of the Cesarlik incident, resulting in three deaths of investigators, also in car crashes. But the only man who goes to jail, although 45 MPs are indicted, is the man driving the truck that the car smashes into. Nevertheless, the investigations did successfully underline the scale of the $50 billion drug trade accelerating through the deep state, the mafia, the state itself, the police, the PKK, who are also involved, the state politicians and these assassins. After his release from hospital, Sadat Bujak here, the only survivor, well, you may not be surprised to hear, but he claims he has amnesia. He has no memory of the accident whatsoever. So how might we conclude? Permanent emergency and conspiracy are becoming default assumptions in an age of tension, which might wisely default to distrust everything and everyone. Cesarlik was not quite an event that changes things, dividing them into a before and an after, but it is a demonstration of the event itself, as that which divides a before from an after. Asking how these four people came to be in the same car provided a moment of illumination that allowed covert connections only guessed at to be named, made, and claimed. The public response in Turkey was one of the biggest civil protests in Turkish history. For many Turks, there are two events that define the consciousness of a generation. One is the 1980s coup, and the other might be said to be the Cesarlik scandal. However, it must be stated that the state also understands this well and has maneuvered to use it to its advantage today. Since Cesarlik, the public has not only had to deal with the deep state itself, but also the use of the deep state image by the state to play victim whilst the government completes its own institutionalisation over this antagonism. So we can see this in the recent arrests and harassments being orchestrated by the AKP party. But also we can see it in legislation, in how the specially authorised prosecutor has been blocked from investigating Undersecretary of the National Intelligence Organization. This is a law that was passed in just a few days, and it now obliges permission of the Prime Minister before any investigation can take place. So this means the power to control possible deep state operations is directly held by the Prime Minister, who creates a limitless area of immunity. Where then can people go for justice? We've moved into an era where the performance of what is legal and what is illegal reveals the dual domination of the state-deep state agenda. The issue is not that the deep state exists. This can be said to be in the consciousness. The problem is that the deep state can be found guilty in absentia of killing an Armenian journalist, for example, but no one goes to prison. A dangerous repeating cycle where act and alibi have become synchronous in law. The deep state did it. Or the problem is that law is being established by first using the force and then making a new type of law de facto applicable for the violence already underway. A move from accidentality to institutionality, seen in Guantanamo, terror laws, police violence, WMD, drone attacks, journalist arrests, mass surveillance, immigration policy, supermax prisons. In all such cases, catastrophe is not something that descends from afar, like an enemy army. Catastrophe is internal to the system. It inhabits the polis, and it wants to convince you that it is just another citizen. Thank you.
I want to thank you all for staying. What has been incredible, but also really dense. And I'm also feeling, I'm feeling saturated, but I'm feeling, you know, empowered. I'm feeling inflated and deflated. I'm feeling a lot of things, you know, feeling a lot of things. And I also, I mean, very briefly, Brad and I have been in a conversation, so the we comes up a lot, you know, and I have to say, we've been in this conversation for 20 years as a primary conversation that's had many other collaborators and collective ways of producing material things in the world that can be considered on one side art, and a lot of other things which are to do with practices of being, belonging, togetherness. At the same time, and this isn't a contradiction, we've also been in a process of uncoupling a togetherness, so uncoupling a shape. So and so this is the first time in our practice where Brad and I have been in two completely different spaces, and we haven't spoken about, so his presentation and my presentation is a conversation, but it's a conversation in two separate spheres. And the sphere that I've been in is, just to give you a tiny context, so I've been in, I've been living on a canal boat in the north of England, in Lancashire, in a post-Brexit context, which has the history of the Industrial Revolution and the textile mills, that also has the kind of geopolitical forces of migration and immigration. And I'm living in a largely Pakistani Muslim community on board a boat, which is called, the project's called Idle Women. And I would describe that this project is pretty much, it's a feminist pirate utopia. So I've been in a space of very separate to London and to the urbanism, a very different kind of politics of the north of England and the politics of the south. And I've had a space in which to connect. Actually, I've had psychic space, which I actually haven't had, I don't think, for such a long time. So I'm living on my own, and the boat functions as a private living space, but also a workshop space. So I hold workshops for women and young girls on this boat. So the reason I'm saying that is because I'm connecting with something that I'm thinking through and wanting to share as a thinking out loud, because this isn't any way formulated. I'm really following like intuitive. I'm trying to touch practices and intuitions that have been structurally dispossessed and practices of persecution that go way back, that goes way back to the Middle Ages, the Dark Ages. So the connections and the links are, I've been looking at and trying to think through esoteric practices, esoteric and occult practices, in relationship to politics, or to trying to think about the kind of space of bringing these spheres of emancipatory, or thinking about politics in relationship to the occult or esotericism. And I did a body of work last year called The Ectoplasm of Neoliberalism. And I was looking at, and I am still looking at, again, because this is this intersectionality of racial, gender, class-based oppression, which is old, so old that we all know. But what I was looking at was the working class mediums, Victorian working class mediums, and this kind of politics of class within the sort of parlor games of fortune telling or seance, or this is in the context as well of empire and patriarchy. So I was looking at these practices, and one woman in particular, I was looking at her because she was the last woman in the UK to be tried in 1944 under the 1735 Witchcraft Act. Yeah, exactly. So when I found this, you know, so, and her name's Helen Duncan, and she was, I was interested in her because she was also one of the most infamous mediums for producing ectoplasm. And again, ectoplasm is something which is on both sides of science and esoteric practices. It's still not completely known or named. You know, is it cloth? Is it a textile? Is it a slime? It's the manifestation between the living and the dead, between the manifestation of spirit. So I was thinking that this was a really great metaphor to think about neoliberalism as this ectoplasm and this manifestation that is deeply embedded in this long racial, gender, class-based oppression. So I would like to invite my glamorous assistant to basically, in this moment, I'm sharing with you. So I have decided, I've been working with fragments, and I always work with fragments. I struggle with writing in terms of constructing an argument in a kind of, and I struggle a lot with the academy, in the kind of, so I've been working with these fragments and readings that I've been doing on this boat in this feminist pirate utopia, and with your permission, I'm going to try something I've never done before. So with these fragments, just earlier this morning, I used the tarot. I used the tarot to construct a reading of these fragments. So I have no idea how, I mean, this is live. This is live with you now. So my first fragment, and this is my slide. This is my analog slide. And I would also just like to bring out the fact, of course, the word witch, I think of as Obeya, it's Bandit Queen, Dakurani. Dakurani is Bandit Queen in Hindi. As like I said, it's which is the intersexuality of racial, gender, class oppression. So the first card that I pull, the first card will be the issue. The issue in the question of the divination, this tool. And divination is not in the sense like a fortune telling, it's an insight into the present condition. So the first card I will read will be the issue. The second fragment of text I will read is going to be the internal influence that we are unable to see. So that's the context in which the second fragment will be read in. The third fragment will be read in the external. So this is the external influence of which we are aware. And then the fourth fragment will be what is needed for resolution. So what is the insight into this tool of divination? And the last fragment will be the resolution, the understanding. So, okay. So the issue. The card I pulled was Audre Lorde. As women, we have come to distrust that power which rises from our deepest and non-rational knowledge. And that fragment comes from a text, The Uses of the Erotic. And I just have a little bit more on this fragment. So we have been warned against it all our lives by the male world, which values this depth of feeling enough to keep women around in order to exercise it in the service of men, but which fears this same depth too much to examine the possibilities of it within themselves. So women are maintained at a distant, inferior position to be psychically milked, much the same way ants maintain colonies of aphids to provide a life-giving substance for their masters. So that is the issue. So the internal influence. And this is a fragment from a book that I found, and a text that has again captured my imagination, and I'm, like I said, I'm thinking this out loud with you now. So this is from a book. It's a text called Bugs and Beasts Before the Law. E.P. Evans compiled this book and this research in 1906. Criminal Prosecution and Capital Punishment is another subtitle of the book. So all over Europe, throughout the Middle Ages, and right on into the 19th century, animals were tried for human crimes. Dogs, pigs, cows, rats, and even flies and caterpillars were arraigned in court on charges ranging from murder to obscenity. The trials were conducted with full ceremony. Evidence was heard on both sides. Witnesses were called, and in many cases, the accused animal was granted a form of legal aid, a lawyer being appointed at the taxpayer's expense to conduct the animal's defence. In 1490, Helen Duncan's channeling. In 1494, this so interests me. I mean, what's happening in Ottoman times in 1494? What's happening in terms of transportation and slavery? What's happening in Europe? So, in 1494, for example, near Clermont in France, a young pig was arrested for having strangled and defaced a child in its cradle. Several witnesses were examined who testified that on the morning of Easter Day, the infant being left alone in its cradle, the said pig entered during the said time, the said house, and disfigured and ate the face and neck of the said child, which in consequence departed this life. Having weighed up the evidence and found no extenuating circumstances, the judge gave sentence. We, in detestation and horror of the said crime, and to the end that an example may be made and justice maintained, have said, judged, sentenced, pronounced, and appointed that the said porker, now detained as a prisoner and confined in the said abbey, shall be, by the Master of High Works, hanged and strangled on a gibbet of wood. So Evans' book details more than 200 said cases. Sparrows being prosecuted for chattering in church, a pig executed for stealing a communion wafer, a cock burnt at the stake for laying an egg. Bartholomew Chassenet, a French jurist of the 16th century, who made his reputation at the bar as the defence counsel for some rats. The rats have been put on trial in the ecclesiastical court on the charge of having feloniously eaten up and wantonly destroyed the local barley. When the culprits did not in fact turn up in court on the appointed day, Chassenet made use of all his legal cunning to excuse them. They had, he urged in the first place, probably not received the summons since they moved from village to village. But even if they had received it, they were probably too frightened to obey, since, as everyone knew, they were in danger of being set on by their mortal enemies, the cats. On this point, Chassenet addressed the court at some length, in order to show that if a person be cited to appear at a place to which he cannot come in safety, he may legally refuse. The judge, recognising the justice of this claim, but being unable to persuade the villagers to keep their cats indoors, was obliged to let the matter drop. For an animal found guilty, the penalty was dire. The Normandy pig was charged with having torn the face and arms of a baby in its cradle. The pig was sentenced to be mangled and maimed in the head forelegs, and then dressed up in a jacket and breeches to be hung from a gallows in the market square. In 1587, a gang of weevils, you know what weevils are, these little bugs, tiny little things, accused of damaging a vineyard, were deemed to have been exercising their natural rights to eat, and in compensation were granted a vineyard of their own. In 1457, a sow was convicted of murder and sentenced to be hanged by the hind feet from a gallows tree. Her six piglets, being found stained with blood, were included in the indictment as accomplices. But no evidence was offered against them. On account of their tender age, they were acquitted. In 1750, a man and a she-ass were taken together in an act of buggery. The prosecution asked for the death sentence for both of them. After due process of law, the man was sentenced, but the animal was let off on the ground that she was the victim of violence and had not participated in her master's crime of her own free will. The local priest gave evidence that he had known the said she-ass for 4 years, that she had always shown herself to be virtuous and well-behaved, that she had never given occasion of scandal to anyone, and therefore he was willing to bear witness that she is in word and deed, in all her habits of life, a most honest creature. So Evans cites cases of inanimate objects being brought before the law. In Greece, a statue that fell on a man was charged with murder and sentenced to be thrown into the sea. In Russia, a bell that pealed too gleefully on the occasion of the assassination of a prince was charged with treason and exiled to Siberia. Evans tells of the bodies of criminals already dead being brought to trial. Pope Stephen the Sixth, on his accession in 896, accused his predecessor Formosus of sacrilegiously bringing the papal office into disrepute. The body of the dead pope was exhumed, dressed in the pontifical robes, and set up on a throne in St. Peter's, where a deacon was appointed to defend him. When the verdict of guilty was pronounced, the executioner thrust Formosus from the throne, stripped him of his robes, cut off the three benedictory fingers of his right hand, and threw his body as a pestilential thing into the Tiber. So this was the internal influence. So this, I'm going to read a fragment, is the external influence of which we are aware. So this is recalling fragments, Sim Elif Kaplan, Helen Duncan, and I. Draw close, draw into, echo of internalized state power, the spectral voice of the Iron Lady, physical, ecto, class, body, irrational. I spit, I foam, I fall from my chair, I reel, I reveal, white. Whiteness is foaming from within. It rises up. The red light bulb pulls it out from beneath. Stripped, tapes were swathed twice. Mouth. The room is lit by four dark red electric lights. It is a little bit warm. I am waiting for the cooling down. I want him to feel it. Advance, please. Didn't you think it had some kind of smell? Yes, it has a smell. I cannot define it. There's a very delicate smell, not like anything I know. Do you see the medium? The psychoplasm is building up rapidly in an upward motion that sounds like a bone cracking. The medium comes forward in deep trance, out of the cabinet, without the sack, and sits on a chair in the circle. Members of the circle get up and examine the sack and seals and are unanimous in declaring them to be intact. Everyone seems to think I am something supernormal. Ectoplasm streaming from the mouth, she comes right in front of the light. Then she turns and walks right out of the circle with the ectoplasm, which is now 12 to 13 feet long, coming down from her mouth. A little darkness, please. How did it feel to be inspected? Was it a familiar, supportive ritual, part of the test conditions? What parts of your body as medium belong in service to the community? The ones that seek, rather than the rights of privacy and trust of the seer. Touch, dressed by the other, satin black knickers folded and unfolded as rite, ritual, as interrogative. I step into the garments, my naked flesh fills the room, the glance of shame of not affording me the respect, trust and privacy. I hold my thoughts to myself. I move my body, eyes, gaze, test conditions of sitting. The sitters take power over my body through introspection. Then come the husbands of the wives. They inspect my orifices, mouth, nostrils, vagina. 7 minutes after the medium was put into the chair, a strip of white substance about a foot in length appeared between the curtains. Albert, would anyone care to feel the substance now? Inspected, trussed up, bagged. Albert, the male voice, speaks on behalf of Helen. Touch, curtains, black satin, hands held firmly to one's side body, temperature rising, bone density lighter, floating. Space opens up between bone, muscle, tissue, movement, dropping in, circulating, breathing, faster and slower. The mind steps aside. The voice echoes in the chamber that is so empty. It's not my voice. It's male, clammy, outside formed, eyes turned in, blackness, dryness, breath on the surface of the skin, voice as vibration, rising, curtain, contained, straps tighten, voices in the room, shrinking, collapsing, withdrawing, half in, half out, breathing faster, porous, plasma, present, broken reality, coming back, red light, exhaustion, affective, in effect of, in service to, who, coagulated dead labour, a speech act made slime on, the parlour floor, industrial labour, an immaterial production. I'm back. So, what is needed for resolution? This is a fragment, fiction, from The Daylight Gate, written by Jeanette Winterson. It's a fiction about the historical facts of the 1612 Lancashire Pendle witch trial. And this is a tiny fragment in the middle of the book. As they took their seats for the play, Alice and Shakespeare were talking. He had met her many years ago. He said when he was new to London, just come from Stratford, and she had her house on Bankside, by the Swan Theatre. She had welcomed him like a northern woman. He liked northern women for their forthrightness and their kindness. He had met many of them when he was a young man here at Horton Tower. We were all Catholics then, he said, even when we were not. Oh, we were young then, said Alice. Shakespeare looked at her curiously. Even when we were not, she blushed. He was like an owl, bright-eyed, his head perched on his ruff. His eyes looked deeper than his gaze. And Alice felt that he knew everything and that there was nothing she need say. He was a wealthy man now, living in Stratford, no longer writing plays. He had travelled up to see The Tempest at Horton Tower because he was fond of the place and fond of the play. His company was still the King's men, and The Tempest had been chosen for the wedding of King James's daughter to take place the following year. I have ridden out all the storms, said Shakespeare, even the ones I wrote myself. Here, look, it begins. A tempestuous noise of thunder and lightning heard. Enter a shipmaster and a boatswain. Master, boatswain, boatswain. Here, master, what cheer? Alice's mind moved in and out of the play. She remembered Shakespeare coming to her house, but he had had long hair, an earring, a beautiful beard. She had not recognised him this time. As the play was performed, she seemed to hear Elizabeth's voice again, and they were together in the house on Bankside, upstairs in their secret private rooms that looked over the River Thames and across London, the great city. Did you sell your soul, Lizzie? The dark gentleman would take a soul. It need not be my own. I doubt another will go to hell to pay for your pleasure. You do not believe in hell or souls, do you, Alice? I believe that you are changed. Alice looked up, startled from her dreaming by the stronger dreaming of the play. Ariel, full fathom five, thy father lies. Of his bones are coral made, those are pearls that were his eyes. Nothing of him that doth fade, but doth suffer a sea change into something rich and strange. Alice fainted. When she came to, she was in a small room, away from the main hall. She could hear that the play was continuing. Her servant stood over her. William Shakespeare took the water from him and gave it to her. He said he was flattered that his little play had had such an effect on her. She had got lost in time, she said. Time, he said. Yes. Yes, time was the kind of place where you could get lost. Then she said to him, and she did not know why she said it, do you believe in magic? Why are you asking me, an actor and an old penman, when you worked with John Dee and Edward Kelly? You knew them? I knew anyone interesting to know. Tell me, do you think a stone statue can come to life? I have used that device in a play I am still revising called The Winter's Tale. The end cannot succeed unless you believe, just for one moment. The statue could perhaps step down and embrace you, return what you had lost. John Dee made a metal beetle that flew like a living thing. He was arrested for it as sorcery. You can get arrested for anything these days, but I don't think I can end my play with a metal beetle, however lifelike. You haven't answered me, said Alice. Shakespeare shook his head and sunk his chin into his ruff, making him look more owl-like than ever. I have written about other worlds often enough. I have said what I can say. There are many kinds of reality. This is but one kind. He stretched out his hands to indicate the walls, carpets, tapestries, and stuffs around him. But mistress, do not be seen to stray too far from the real that is clear to others, or you may stand accused of the real that is clear to you. So, the understanding. So the last short fragment I'm going to read, which is from a feminist political sci-fi that was written 40 years ago and has also been reissued with a text by the author this year, actually. So it's Woman on the Edge of Time by Marge Piercy. That unknown, precious country of her brain. They had a dummy second machine, like the one sitting on her skull, squatting like a mosquito, about to draw blood, and they were fiddling with the dummy. She would have loved to try it out on them. Suddenly she thought that these men believe feeling itself a disease, something to be cut out like a rotten appendix, cold, calculating, ambitious, believing themselves rational and superior. They chased the crouching female animal through the brain with a scalpel. From an early age, she'd been told that what she felt was unreal and didn't matter. Now they're about to place in her something that would rule her feelings like a thermostat. Time, yes, the surprise was the boredom. She could almost have slept, hunched there. The green masks of the robbers covered their faces, but she could easily tell Dr. Redding from Dr. Morgan. Redding was brisk and in control and chipper. Morgan was prissy with worry, his every motion a bureaucratic procedure judged against inner or outer rules. Now a new object was presented, crowned over. The nurses crowded close to see the new toy. It was a metal disc embossed like a coin, no bigger than a quarter, with tubes and a miniature dialysis bag attached. She would be a walking monster with a little computer inside and a year's supply of dope to keep her stupid. The whole thing would fit in the palm of her hand. It would fit under the roof of her skull, perched cosily on the brain. Her head felt wrong as they put it in. Everything felt wrong. Maybe it would feel right again. They were closing with cement, a temporary measure. They said they wanted to monitor the reading for a month or two. They might want to change the chemical she was being fed from that dialysis bag. They kept their options open with a cement plug. So, thank you for... so that's... that's the fragments in which I've presented the... I don't even know if we have time to even begin to share what it even means. What does it mean to even bring this to the table and to bring these fragments into, even into themselves, but also to bring them into the other presentations? That I feel there's so many echoes and traces throughout the last day and previous evening that keep turning the threads and the insight and the revelations and the pain. You know, that there's a lot of pain in this, in some of these fragments, but also in the moment which you shared with us as well, and we've all shared. Thank you. That's all. Yeah.